Good afternoon to our guests and participants, and thank you for dialing in to our webinar today. I'm Dixon Wong from Invest Hong Kong, Head of Financial Services. A bit of housekeeping, the panel section will run for 45 minutes. We have with us today Ernest Ho on my left-hand side. Next to me is Hannes Hoffman. Both gentlemen are senior and experienced private bankers. Ernest is Managing Director of Hong Kong team at JP Morgan Private Bank. Hannes is Managing Director leading JP Morgan Private Bank's International Multifamily Office and Intermediary Business. So Ernest and Hannes, could you introduce yourselves and briefly the team where you represent? Please, over to you.
Yeah, certainly. Thank you, Dixon, and thank you, Invest Hong Kong, for having us today. It's a great privilege of ours to be partnering with you guys today to discuss this topic. My name is Ernest. I work for JP Morgan Hong Kong team and have been a banker at the Hong Kong team for the past 13 years. My remit of service and focus is in the ultra high net worth segment within the Hong Kong market. And many of my clients, in fact, very pertinent to the topic, are family offices, whether they're single or multifamily offices.
Yeah, I also wanted to thank you for being here. But what Ernest probably didn't say yet is you are actually the first guest we have on the stage as an organization doing an event with us from
very
this
grateful.
Venue. So we're very happy to be able to do that. I've been with JP Morgan for 18 years in many different places around the world, New York, London, Miami, and now for the last 5 years, Hong Kong. I don't have to tell you, for JP Morgan, Hong Kong is an unbelievably attractive place to do business in. And for the last year, I've had the privilege, really, to build JP Morgan's multifamily office offering globally, something that we haven't done before, but we've understood how important family offices are, and we wanted to build a special team for that. So I'm very happy to be here in Hong Kong, running this effort globally from Hong Kong.
Thank you, Ernest, and thank you, Hans. In Hong Kong, the wealth of ultra-high net worth families is estimated at $1.2 trillion. There are 84,000 ultra-high net worth families based in mainland China and 19,300 ultra-high net worth families are based in the Greater Bay Area. And this represents more than 20% of the total. And we expect continued strong momentum in the listing IPO activities, with an estimated over $30 billion to be raised in Hong Kong for the full year 2020. All this contributes to a growing demand for the family office setup in Hong Kong. Before we start the panel section, please let me have a few minutes to introduce Invest Hong Kong. Who we are and what we do. Invest Hong Kong is a government department responsible for attracting foreign and mainland investors to set up business in Hong Kong and help them achieve success in one of these, the most business-friendly cities in the world. We have 10 specialist teams to assist clients at all stages of the business, from planning stage to the launch of the business and to further expansion. We provide clients with information on market data, relevant laws, regulations, as well as business professional services and marketing support. More specifically, Invest Hong Kong services include company setup, visa, licensing, schooling support, bank account opening, introduction of service providers, public relations, marketing, publicity support, including office opening ceremony and also press release. There are two major annual flagship events hosted by Invest Hong Kong. The FinTech Week in November and Start Me Up Festival in February each year. So what we do at headquarters in Hong Kong, we have 10 specialist sector teams covering key pillar sectors, financial, innovation, technology, as well as lifestyle and creative industries, plus an aftercare team based in Hong Kong covering the city's priority sectors. Our overseas network of staff and representatives based in over 30 key business cities worldwide work closely with specialist teams in Hong Kong to help foreign and mainland companies set up and expand in our city, regardless of the size and the business development stage. So Invest Hong Kong actually offers a wide range of customized services to support family office setup. We are also a central point of contact that can connect clients with relevant government departments and regulators in Hong Kong, such as Hong Kong MA, SFC, and Stock Exchange. And other engagement collaborations with industry key stakeholders, like business collaborations with university, academics, and market players. Like today, we have a webinar with JP Morgan. Briefly, our global FO or Family Office Engagement Program, there are some key areas that I would like to highlight is a few objectives is to position Hong Kong as a leading family office hub in Asia, and also provide a one-stop platform to facilitate clients setting up a family office in the city, and also support family office already established in Hong Kong to expand the business here. And more importantly, facilitate discussions between family offices and the stakeholders, regulators, and government departments. So our key target markets would be mainland market, mainland China, Asia, ASEAN, as well as Europe, Middle East, and also North America. Invest Hong Kong resources, we have a family office website recently launched in our Invest Hong Kong micro website, and also a pitch book flyer to be published by end of the year. There are regular events held and hosted by Invest Hong Kong, and also the quarterly newsletter published by our financial services team. So all this, you can find it online in our website. Perhaps we should start our panel sections. Asia is home to 38% of world billionaire populations. Only about 17% of single family office are present in Asia. As compared to US and Europe, it is probably less than 10%. Are you ready to take action to capture this opportunity? We have two experts here today. Ernest, can I ask you the first question? What is family office? And what are the common types of family office in Hong Kong?
Thank you, Dixon, and thank you for that great introduction into what Invest Hong Kong does. I think to address that, I mean, a family office in its simplest form really is a private office that helps to manage the wealth of families with significant wealth. In its simplest form, you know, family office can offer services such as concierge service, secretarial services, or more often than not, as a defining trait of a family office is the management of family assets, whether they're financial assets, will assets, direct investments, bookkeeping, tax administration, et cetera. The more complex types of family offices, and when I say complex, I mean when they deal with multiple generations of family members, multiple branches across jurisdictions and geographies, a family office can act as a central hub for the family enterprise as it comes to family governance and succession planning type of issues. So really, you have family offices that could range in terms of scope of services as well as size. It could be anywhere from a few persons to as more as 100. And we've seen these sizes, of course, not only outside of Hong Kong, but inside of Hong Kong as well. And we as a firm, JP Morgan, we work closely with these family offices. Broadly speaking, two main buckets of family office. You have what's called the single family office. And that's really a family office that takes care of the interests and goals of one family, right? Again, depending, it doesn't matter what the size is, but it's one single family. The other type is the multi-family office. And that is a family office by name and definition that takes care of the interests of potentially unrelated families. They could be private, which is often seen as owned and operated by one founding family member. They build track record, then they offer their investments or asset management insights to other families, usually friends of theirs. Then you have commercial multifamily offices, and those are largely commercial third-party entities that offer services to families across geographies. One interesting tidbit that I like to share And most of our audience may not know this, is that the Heritage J.P. Morgan is actually one of the first family offices found in the late 19th century when it was created to manage the wealth of Mr. Morgan, which was created during the booming days of the oil, gas, steel, and railroad industries in the U.S., and has slowly transitioned to become a multifamily office offering banking and investment advisory services to families across the globe over the last 125 years.
Great. You touched briefly on some of the services offered by family offices in Hong Kong. Can you elaborate further on some of the common service requirements among the family office setting up in Hong Kong, and perhaps how banks or other service providers that they can play a role here?
Great. I think the way I would address this is to look at what are the commonalities in terms of service requirements of family offices. And I largely categorize them into four buckets. And it really depends on the complexity of the family. It could be as simple as a few things, or it could be a very complex family that requires a lot more services. So some of the times these buckets of services can be internalized by the family office themselves, or more often than not, we're seeing they're subcontracted to, for example, firms like us, or other professional entities to help them manage. So the four buckets, if you can largely kind of mentalize this, is administration services, right? This includes bookkeeping, communications, IT. And increasingly nowadays, what we see is the family office's focus in cybersecurity. As you know, because of COVID, we have accelerated our activities. A lot of this is done online now. And end clients of family office demand this cybersecurity, watertight type of service, not only from their banks, but from the intermediaries as well. So this is a very interesting and growing area that family offices need to address and look at. Interesting fact for you is JP Morgan has spent more than $3 billion in cybersecurity since 2015. And just in 2019, we spent more than $600 million in cybersecurity alone. We've created four centers of cybersecurity response around the world that offers 24/7 global coverage to help mitigate and respond to cybersecurity threats. The second bucket are professional services, right? And that could include services such as family governance, succession planning, trust planning, and even lifestyle, right? Art management, yacht, aircraft management, etc. Then you have general services, right? These are the tax, legal, perhaps insurance-related type of services. But finally, I guess the investment advisory bucket is where banks really play a role, a bigger role in terms of helping the clients, the family office clients. And this could include multi-asset, right, type of portfolio construction, portfolio management, manager selection, for example. A lot of times family offices look to their private wealth management partners or banks to help them do due diligence and ongoing monitoring of investments, right? Other services from banks could include access to direct investments, alternative investments such as hedge funds and private equity, and increasingly so nowadays is ESG, right? Mm. Environmental, social, governance type of investments, philanthropy, right? And most importantly is risk management. But I would say for banks now, focusing on how banks play a role, family offices, there are three key ingredients I think family offices look for as they choose a banking or a private wealth management partner. The first one is, of course, because of what I said before, a lot of times banks help on the investment process, and therefore they look for a bank with the investment prowess that are able to connect the clients to a breadth and depth of solutions, of investment solutions, and more particularly so in the case of Hong Kong, is to use Hong Kong and take advantage of our unique position as a gateway into China. So a lot of family offices setting up shop in Hong Kong, they really look at what are the banks that they're partnering with that has this access and has this breadth and depth to help the common end client. Another key point is the stability of the bank's balance sheet, because I think ever since the financial crisis and the uncertainties that are present nowadays, family offices as a client and their end clients are looking to bank with partners that are stable, right? Take JP Morgan, for instance. Again, our CET1 capital is near $200 billion. And we've been seen as a place of safe haven during times of crisis where they don't have to worry about the custody, the safe custody of their assets. And sometimes for those who borrow is suddenly reduction of lending practices or changes of lending practices because of the balance sheet the bank faces. So stability is also a key point. Last but not least is a partner that can invest in the future, right? A partner that has the balance sheet and is able to invest into technology that is poised to help clients into the future. And again, I just want to use that as an example. We've invested more than $10 billion a year in technologies such as AI, machine learning, and blockchain. And these are already benefiting not only family offices, but our end clients as well.
Great. Completely agree. These are the most important factors for family office to consider when they selecting a banking or PWM partner. Is there anything else that they should pay attention to in order to differentiate banking or private wealth management partner in your view?
So I think those three key points that I talked about, again, balance sheet, the investment prowess, as well as the ability to invest in the future are usually the key ones. But depending on the family office and their goals that they serve for their end clients, there are other things that family office might want to consider as they go and look for a partner to bank with, quote unquote, right? And these could be, you know, do I want to work with a broker dealer as opposed to a fiduciary mindset type of a institution where they'll also offer help on investment advice, portfolio management, most importantly, again, is risk management. I talked about ESG, right? Does this partner offer sustainable ESG type of impact investments? Because I think this is an area of growing interest in families as the wealth transition is happening from founder generations to the second and third generations where they want to create a legacy as well. Third is perhaps important to a family office and their end clients is access to a strong IB franchise. I think family offices, depending again on their complexity, could have, and we work with many of these clients in Hong Kong, internalized a research-based type of a team that would need access to world-class type of research. They might want corporate access, the ability to meet with the management of the companies that they might take a stake in, or perhaps capital market deal flows, right? Not only are they investing in deals, but also is the bank or the partner able to provide solutions for the family's operating business? Electronic trading services might be another area that they would be interested to look in. Lending, not only the plain vanilla type of portfolio-based lending, but perhaps structured type of lending, concentrated stocks, aircraft, art financing, for example. I think wealth advisory as another differentiator is, you know, whether a family office, if they have not internalized this, are they able to recognize and find a partner who's able to not only have a team of advisors providing health check and advice to their clients, but also, you know, perhaps having a trustee service offered as well. And perhaps the last point is global connectivity. Besides just banking in Hong Kong with a partner here, can my partner also serve the needs of my broader family branches who might be in Europe or North America? A one-stop shop, if you would, that can offer, again, banking needs globally, and more importantly, connecting families regionally across the world who might share the similar interest. So I think those points are also different or perhaps important differentiators, again, depending on the end client that the family office serves.
Thank you. I think, Hans, the next question goes to you. What is the multifamily office and why is it relevant, you know, to investors as an FO? And what are the key elements to consider, you know, how we should start?
Yeah. That? So I've brought a slide. I hope the audience
can
see this. Yeah. Look, the way I think about this is Ernest just spent a lot of time talking about single family offices, which I think a lot of people are familiar with. And in some ways, when we look at how do single family offices typically progress, right? So how do successful single family offices that have been set up to manage money for one family, how do they usually grow? Very often they follow a growth pattern where at one point, and we highlighted this on the slide, but at one point they're figuring out, wow, we're good at what we do. We've actually good people. We've got a good office space. We work well with the family who funded us. Why don't we take these services? And we think about, instead of being a cost center, right? We think about, apart from costing the family who supports us money, why don't we turn ourselves into someone who can actually make revenue by offering services to other families as well? And Ernest briefly mentioned, like, this idea when he talked about different types of family offices, that friends and family come together and then it can grow further and become a typical professional multifamily office. But one idea is definitely, why don't you take the cost and turn it into revenue? I don't know whether you know this, but there's a study out there that says the average family office incurs a cost of about 1.1% of capital a year. So if you think about, say, you've got $300 million under management, that's about a $3.5 million cost a year for maintaining a family office. Hard to argue that it couldn't be a good idea to find ways to, like, take that cost and make it lower, even turn it into a profit by offering services. The second thing that we find that families often think about is, once you invest well, you're held back by how much capital you have. So imagine you're finding these public market opportunities and you're finding some real estate opportunities and some private investment opportunities. You've got $300 million, which means you're probably not going to put more than, I don't know, $1 million or maybe two or maybe three or maybe five into a specific project. Imagine the project has $30 million of capacity. Well, wouldn't it be great if you could take the analysis you've done, you could open it up to, again, friends, family, you could pool capital, and you can take bigger bites of projects that you like and that you've shown you've got a good track record in. And then the third argument is often an argument of just development also for the people who work for family offices, right? It's great if you work for a family office and you've been well rewarded, but a lot of people who are in the financial industry know the moment where you turn from a cost into a revenue generator, your compensation, your personal compensation is also likely to go up. So very often what we see with regard to multifamily offices is that after a while, successful single family offices are thinking about how can they morph into something bigger, something that's a multifamily office. Two more things I wanted to add here. Sometimes people come to me and they say, like, well, aren't multifamily offices for smaller families and single family offices for the big families? That's absolutely not the case, right? There's research out there that shows that the typical families that work with multifamily offices are within plus minus 10% of the net worth that single family office families have. So there's a lot of families that are very large that like the idea of working together with friends and family and investing together with them. And that makes it attractive. Let me add one final thought, because we are here with Invest Hong Kong, right? So I think a final thought for multifamily offices particularly, a key thing is, how do you attract capital? And when you think about attracting capital, a location like Hong Kong, that is part of the Greater Bay Area, that has one of the most transparent and low tax regimes in the world, that has an incredibly well-defined capital market, right? I mean, very soon, we're probably going to host the biggest IPO ever in the world, that has an extremely good talent pool, right? I've seen numbers that there's over 45,000 CPAs in Hong Kong. There are over 40,000 people in the financial industry. There are over 12,000 barristers and solicitors in Hong Kong. So you've got a lot of professional talent here. You've got a lot of regulations that are very supportive of making this truly a hub for investing in Asia and investing in China. And so Hong Kong, in many ways, is also, I think, a very attractive place for people who consider starting multifamily offices.
Thank you, thank you. Hannes, can you share a few success stories for MFO setup? And what's the bank, or what's your role to help achieving this?
Yeah, of course. Let me spend maybe again 1 second just on the environment. A second slide abroad, maybe we can go to this quickly, is how we think the growth in APEC is going to happen. So the first thing to be said about multifamily offices is Globally, this is an industry that probably handles about 1.5 trillion of assets, right? 1.5 trillion of assets, a lot of money. In Asia right now, we think there's a little bit more than 100 billion probably, but we think the growth rate in the next 5 years, when we look at research, is going to be significant. And Hong Kong obviously is one of the key locations here. So I think from a macro perspective, this is an area that has a lot of room to grow. It's still a lot smaller than in other regions of the world. So if we've got viewers here who sit in Europe, for example, they will be very familiar with the concept. In Asia, it's still a relatively new concept and just catching on, but I think there's a lot of upside. The second thought, one of our competitors did a study with Campton on multifamily offices in China. And what I thought was very interesting, they found that families in China with more than $50 million in net worth, so about 350 million renminbi, 30% of them use single-family offices, 25% use multifamily offices. And more interesting, of those that don't, 44% want to start single-family offices, and 33% want to work with multifamily offices. So what you see again is even amongst the Chinese money, there's a huge interest in either taking advantage of single-family offices or multifamily offices. And final thing here, just to compare to Europe, Switzerland, which is a very developed market here, they've got about 2,200 multifamily offices and external asset managers in Switzerland. They're just changing regulation. And so they asked them, how many of you want to continue doing this business in the next 3 years? 2,100 of 2,200 said, we absolutely want to be in this business and we're going to apply for the relevant license. So the first thing is, the success of the sector for me is without question. And like I said, I think Hong Kong is really well set up. Success stories to think about is whether you think of Rockefeller Family Office that is now handling external people's money, Bessemer Trust that is now handling external money, Guggenheim in the international space that is using external money. There's actually a lot of examples also in Hong Kong. I don't want to name specific Hong Kong entities, but what I can tell you is a number of family offices that have very successfully started to attract money. The key question is always, does the family office really want to take that leap from being a service provider to one family to becoming a professional setup that has its own brand, its own infrastructure, its own people, and is opening up its shop for money coming from outside? There's a number of very successful stories in Hong Kong. One final thought, there are two ways to get there, and sometimes they intermingle. One is, again, you start with one big single family office and one big family, and then you get friends and family, and then you end up with a multifamily office. The other one is, you have a number of bankers. So they don't have a big single family office, but they have a lot of clients they know who trust them and who are willing to give them money. They can also come together, bring capital together, pool capital, and start a multifamily office or external asset manager that way. And we've actually seen, like you can see on the slide, a lot of successes in Hong Kong, and we expect the success to continue over the next few years, funded by money out of China, but also from Europe, in the US and Latin America, who all want to find a good gateway into investing here in Asia.
And I just want to add to that, right? From a personal perspective, as I look at the clientele I serve in Hong Kong, this is definitely the two trends that I see, right? Whether it is single families that have seeded with the owner's capital to start with, they build their track record over a 3-4 year period, and they start offering their investment services to other families, and increasingly so seeing a lot of bankers or financial professionals just coming together and leveraging on their relationships to create these multifamily office type of offerings. So seeing this quite a bit, and this is not only in Hong Kong serving Hong Kong clients or Chinese clients. We've had inbound European clients doing the same thing, setting up family offices in Hong Kong and perhaps looking to us for advice and talking about how is the best to to manage that journey.
And that's a good, because you said, what's your role in achieving this? Look, the fact that I'm now for a year running this multifamily office effort globally, we've got people in Latin America, we've got people in Europe, we've got people in Asia, is because the most important role we can play is to be a partner bank that can use our institutional capabilities, our global reach, our understanding of what these multifamily offices need as financial intermediaries, really, right? Who are building a business out of advising clients, and we take that very seriously. So we've got the legal agreements in place, the technology in place, the product offering in place, in order to be a good partner to help people achieve that journey that becomes a very successful multifamily office.
And this is not only one way from us, right? Talk about the right. Max, for example, the Max event that we put on together every year, this Morgan Advisors Exchange. And this is a program that we purposely try to connect family office leaders to meet with other family offices around the world. So it's not only an AP Morgan, One Direction type of, this is what we think you should be doing, but they get a chance to also mingle and meet with other family offices to hear what are the issues and interests they're facing, to talk about it publicly amongst different family office leaders, and to kind of internalize and bring back home. So these are very helpful type of things that perhaps a banking provider could help with.
Thank you. Thank you, Ernest and Hannes, for sharing your insightful views and information on that. And if I could summarize the key points from each of you, from Ernest, we now understand there are different types and also size of a single family office in Hong Kong. And there are also major types of services for family office required from a service provider perspective or bank's perspective. And also there are key considerations for FO to select when they are selecting a service provider. And we also note the comment on the important access to GBA, capital, PE deal flows, talents that Ernest has mentioned. And from Hannes, we learned that the on the multifamily office front, there are major differences between private MFO and also commercial MFO. And also there are key elements to consider when starting MFO and also some success stories for MFO setup in Hong Kong with the help of JP Morgan. So really, really grateful for all this advice and also guidance from a private experience, the private banker's perspective. If we can move into the Q&A section, we have some questions received by email earlier. We summarized here, which are common to many of the other questions. So the first question, why Hong Kong has plenty of potential to develop as a hub for family office, what we should take into consideration in terms of competition from other countries. So perhaps if I can ask Ernest, if you don't mind to share your view on that.
Well, look, I think Asia will continue to be a very interesting place for family office to look into setting up a diversified play because of just the opportunity set available in Asia, and a lot of reports pointing, of course, to the tremendous growth that Asia will see in the future. So I think competition is going to be there regardless, right? And Hong Kong definitely faces a lot of competition as it comes to attracting family offices. So like take Singapore, for instance, right? I mean, that's, you know, elephant in the room. We always like to kind of use that as a comparison. Look, Singapore is just as competitive as it relates to Hong Kong, right? As it relates to government support, tax treatment, citizenship requirements, investment hurdles, and so on and so forth. But I think one key thing that family offices need to bear in mind when they choose an Asian city is, where are the talent? Where am I going to find a partner who's going to be able to give me the desired access that I want? For example, we talked about this again, both Hannes and I, is again taking the unique advantage of Hong Kong being a gateway for capital flows into and out of China, right? So this is very important because we find that this is most often the case to make for family office to set up in Hong Kong. Just the community of investors, the community of financial professionals, the community of banks and service providers in Hong Kong, is very helpful, and it's such a small place. And again, of course, a lot of mainland Chinese investors coming to Hong Kong and just building those bridges. So Hong Kong will continue to play, I think, a key role. And this is something that I think family offices need to bear in mind as they choose where they want to set up location.
Right. The second question, where do you see challenges for family office that would like to expand into MFO? I think, Hannes, you mentioned about the potential growth in the city in view of the there are many opportunities coming from Greater Bay Area and also the financial market, capital, IPO. Hong Kong, you know, probably will take very huge IPO here. So if you can share with us your view on that.
So challenges as a single family office, if you want to expand into, yeah. Look, I mean, like I said before, it's a big leap of faith, right? Because you're going from being an office that is very much targeted towards servicing typically one master, right? Like your principal family. You're taking that leap of faith to becoming a professional for-profit business. And so I don't think it's very different. I do not think it's very different from taking a private company like public, right? You just have to decide that you're okay with investing into a professional setup. That means you will get a lot more transparency, you get a lot more professionalization. You lose probably some flexibility and some control when I think about the principal. But in return, again, you turn 1.1% average cost for running a multifamily office into potentially a profit generator. And so the way I would think about this is you'll have to get regulated, right? So in Hong Kong, typically, in order to manage money from other families, you will need a type 1, type 4, type 9 license by the SFC. That sounds very innocent, but what that means is you might get a regulatory audit, right? So when you get a regulatory audit, it takes a lot of resources to make sure you sit down with the regulator, you show that you're fully compliant, that you've got the infrastructure. You need to build a compliance system. You need to put a compliance group into place. You need to be aware of the rules and regulations and you need to follow them in a way that a single family office doesn't need to do. You need to make sure you treat your clients fairly, right? So a completely new set of thoughts and rules probably is, okay, how do I go from investing on my own behalf into making sure I can document that I do not treat one family ahead of others? How do I just document that? How do I do the bookkeeping? What kind of offices do I need, right? I mean, we all know office space is not cheap in Hong Kong. So how do I turn my office from an office into a brand, into a place where I can receive families and I show them how much I work? What's my strategic growth plan? How much in assets can I gather and by when? Remember, any business you start in the beginning has a J curve. It's exactly the same thing with external asset managers, multifamily offices. There's a J curve of having to get the office space, getting the people, getting the technology, setting up the regulatory program. But then once you dive through the J curve, right, the business typically becomes very attractive. So the numbers that I've seen that people throw out there is that in the current environment, and this is not specific for Hong Kong, but I think that's something that is, if someone thinks about starting a multifamily, you want to have in mind, typically at around 300 to 500 million of assets, does it start to become profitable to run a multifamily office for profit? It depends on how many clients they have, what kind of fee structure they have, what kind of investments they do. But that ability to get to a certain size and to handle the J curve until then is really the key skill. And if you ask me, like you said, what are the main challenges? When I think about family offices I've met that have tried this and then aborted, right? Because there are some, they try it and then they say like, no, it's not worth it. Those are usually the ones who found the time to raise assets to be too long for their taste, or after they considered everything, the buildup of all these functions a little too complex. But I think overall, we're seeing more and more family offices that Ernest talked about who are coming to us and they're telling us they want to aggregate capital because they're seeing such good investment opportunities that they want to be able to invest together with friends. And I personally am seeing also more and more family offices coming to us who are starting this from day one as an attractive business. So while there are challenges, I think for people who are committed and who are willing to ride the J-curve, it can be a very attractive opportunity. And I talked before about the interest that you see from Chinese clients, but also clients around the world in getting services of an MFO.
Thank you. The next question is Hong Kong's unique advantage as the leading international financial center in Asia and its close ties with mainland China. How can we capitalize on these strengths to make it a preferred destination for family office? In front of two experts here, if I can take this briefly, and if there's anything you two experts would like, please feel free to. I think we should understand that families are now establishing the family office in a selected number of global hubs based on a few key factors. For example, I think two experts have earlier mentioned about access to capital, access to PEs, deal flows, and also access to Greater Bay Area. Hong Kong is a tax-friendly city, low and simple tax structure as highlighted by Hannes, and also the talent pool here available, as well as Hong Kong is a center for philanthropy, ESG, impact investing. Last but not the least, Hong Kong is a metropolitan city where people and also investors can communicate with each other in three different languages, English, Mandarin, Cantonese, in this, I think, a business-friendly city. So all this makes Hong Kong a very good mix of doing business here, in particular on the family office. Anything you want to add on top of that, please feel free to.
I'll start. I think, again, just to echo what you said, I think all those points are very valid. What I would add, I think in summary, is to really, for the audience who are considering to set up family offices in Hong Kong, and including what you've mentioned, the advantages that Hong Kong have, is to really then look internally and say, well, first of all, what kind of family office do I want to run? Am I just here to serve one family who wants to have that access, as you said, to all the opportunities in the Greater China region? Or am I thinking about setting up a commercial entity that will potentially be serving multiple families? And Hannes has talked in great depth about what that journey looks like, what are the challenges thereof. But I think what's worth bearing in mind is ultimately reflecting upon that is what services do I want to internalize and what services do I want to subcontract? And fortunately, again, just Hong Kong has a breadth and depth of such service providers, whether they're banks, private wealth managers, law firms, accounting firms, professional organizations that are just able to provide such services. And the experience, of course, of the people and the talent in Hong Kong, not only within JP Morgan, but outside as well, that are able to talk and advise clients accordingly with a very specific regional flair and flavor to it. So I think that's worth considering for the family office, what they want to do and what they want to build and what they want to subcontract out.
And then if I can just add one thing, I would say, like, look, we've had obviously a fair share also of negative headlines in the last 18 months for Hong Kong. And I think it's important that we don't let that distract us from the underlying fabric. And I think Ernest talked a lot about it, and you talked a lot about that. It's like investing in a market, right? You invest in a market, the market takes a down cycle. The bad investors are the ones who run away. The good investors are the ones who see value in the opportunities that opens. So I think in the last 18 months, Hong Kong also had to learn a lot about things that work well, that don't work well, innovate, get better, and maintain that spirit and that linkage into the Greater Bay Area that's so important. So for us, we're a bank with 250,000 people around the world. We have global presence, big investment bank, big commercial bank, big corporate bank, big wealth management business. And we decided that Hong Kong is our headquarters in Asia. I think that's a signal that we want to send. And I'm also very happy that our global multifamily office initiative, I can sit here, do that from Hong Kong with teams around the world. So I would just say, let's all see through the news, That's been good and bad, maybe a little bit more bad in the last 18 months. And let's focus on the opportunities that this location offers.
Thank you. And I'm afraid that is all the time we have for today. And if I could invite Ernest and Hannes each to give 1 minute key takeaway for the audience today. If I, we can start with Ernest.
Well, I think I already spent my minute already summarizing my key takeaway. But one thing that I failed to mention, I think it's worth reiterating, is the importance of working with a partner like you, right? Because this is the initiative, right? Obviously, is to help make the global audience more aware of the advantages and the partners available and the services available at Invest Hong Kong. So definitely do, you know, bark upon that, get in contact with Dixon and the team, and, you know, he'd be able to, Invest Hong Kong will be able to kind of connect you with the right partners.
I definitely spent my 1 minute already. So
thank you both, Ernest and Hannes. Really grateful for all your support here today. And thanks very much for participating in today's webinar. We hope the section today was informative and also useful for all of you. And should you have any follow-up questions, our team is happy to assist and also bring it up to the right person and resources to you. And let's keep in touch. Thank you. Thank you again.